Good morning and welcome to WGN News Now. I am Larry Hawley as we are bringing you live coverage of Pedro Grifol's White Sox managerial introductory news conference at Guaranteed Rate Field. They're just about ready to begin right now. As you can see, Len Casper, the radio play-by-play voice of the Chicago White Sox, right now at the podium as he's getting ready to introduce Pedro Grifol as the new manager. Let's take you to Guaranteed Rate Field right now.
Family, including his wife, Allie, and his daughters, Lauren, Amanda, and Camilla. Pedro is a Miami, Florida native who attended Florida State, later finished his degree at Excelsior University. He was the Florida High School Player of the Year as a senior and a College All-American in 1991. A catcher by trade, he played 9 seasons in the Twins and Mets systems. He has worked in the Mariners and Royals organizations over the past 23 seasons. You could say he's a lifer. He's been a scout, a minor league manager, instructor, a director of minor league operations, a big league hitting coach, a catching coach, a quality control coach, a bench coach, and a winter league manager. He was on the staff of the World Series winning Kansas City Royals in 2015. And he's now a major league manager. So those are the big resume bullet points, many of which you've already read about. But we'll hear much more about the qualitative part of his background and his resume now. Let's turn the microphone over to the White Sox Senior Vice President and General Manager, Rick Hahn.
Thank you, Len, and thank you all for being here today. And perhaps more importantly, thank you to Major League Baseball for letting us stick to our previous schedule of having this press conference today, despite the World Series rainout. Today's a pretty exciting day around here. You may see me smiling a little bit more than you have over the past year and gushing a little bit more than I have in the past year. And that's because it's a little difficult for me to contain the excitement that many of us feel being able to present to you all Pedro Grifol as our new manager. I will talk a little bit about the process, answer or preemptively give some answers to some things that I'm guessing are on people's mind. We'll then do the awkward jersey thing, and then we'll let Pedro take this thing over. I think as an organization and as a baseball department, Jerry, Kenny, myself, we're very proud of the process that led us to Pedro. It was a exhaustive and expansive search. We've heard me make mention before to our lists in a drawer of potential candidates that we pull out when there is an opening. I think that initial list for manager had about 22 or 24 names on it. As we started to hear from other people in the organization and outside the organization, friends of the program, that list swelled to about 30. We did due diligence on, dug into just about all of them, and ultimately selected 8 to sit down with for first round interviews. Those 8 were from 7 different organizations, including the White Sox, throughout baseball. Those first round interviews involved myself, Chris Getz, Jeremy Haber, and Daniel Zion, all of who are present today, and appreciate the work and effort that our department was able to put into this. Ultimately, Kenny and I sat down with a few candidates, and after that, there was a final round involving finalists with Jerry, Kenny, and myself in Arizona. I will say, and I'll get to this in a moment, a little bit more about why Pedro. But Pedro was actually the second of the 8 that we sat down with. And from about an hour into our conversation, it became very clear that the bar had been risen and that the rest of the group that we were going to be meeting with over the course of the following week or 10 days had a high standard to meet based on what Pedro presented that day. I think at the end of actually our first meeting, I said to him something to the effect that I know obviously you've been working towards becoming a big league manager for the last 20 years or so, and I can't imagine that not happening here in the not too distant future, whether it's with us or somebody else. And we were very fortunate that it wound up being with us in the end. I know there's been some information leaked out prior to today about the status of Pedro's coaching staff. The only thing, or the only specifics I can get in today, or we can get into today, are about those individuals that we are certain will be on his next staff. Ethan Katz and Kurt Hassler will return in their previous roles. And we're pleased to also share with you that Charlie Montoyo will be joining Pedro's staff as a bench coach, as his bench coach. The remainder of those spots, we will go through a process with Pedro to conduct some interviews. We have a number of names, none of which we can really get into specifics about because they are mostly under contract with other clubs. There will be some internal candidates from within the White Sox organization for some of these spots, but I suspect at the end of the day, based on the conversations we've had over the last week or so, or a couple weeks, I should say, that the majority of those spots will be filled by individuals outside the White Sox organization. Why Pedro? This is the part where I need to catch myself a little bit from going too far over the top, a little too gushing perhaps, but we sit here today and with the hiring of Pedro feel like we are taking a major step to putting ourselves back on track on the trajectory that we all felt we were on over the previous seasons prior to last season's disappointment. In Pedro, we are hiring someone who is a renowned communicator, a modern baseball mind who is seeking to build a cohesive and inclusive clubhouse environment, and one where the intention to detail and the accountability will be priorities. Eventually, it's probably more important you hear from the man himself than me. But at the end of the day, after Jerry, Kenny, and I sat down with Pedro, it was very clear to all three of us that he would be the unanimous choice to address some of the things that we needed to improve in. Again, I could go on about this for the next 2 hours probably about how Pedro fits, and I'll answer some of your questions when we get to that point, but I think it's probably more important that you hear from the man himself. So we'll go ahead and with respect to Josh Harrison for sharing his number, and of course Juan Uribe for allowing a number man to wear number 5 for the White Sox, let's go ahead and present to you Pedro Grifol.
This is Larry Hawley from WGN News Now. You can see Pedro Grifol getting the jersey and the hat. I wanted to also mention we are live on Facebook right now. If you have a comment about the new managerial hire, we encourage you to share it. We'll share some of these at the end of the show, but here is the manager, Pedro Grifol.
Rick, for your kind words. First and foremost, I want to thank God for this amazing ride and great opportunity. I want to thank Jerry, Kenny, Rick, Jeremy, Chris, for a very detailed and thorough process full of great baseball conversations. I felt like we were back 20 years ago in the clubhouse just talking baseball and strategy. I want to thank my family here today, my wife, Allie, my daughters Lauren, her fiance Matt, Amanda, her husband Hugo, Camila, no husband and fiancés yet, and my mother-in-law Gloria. A quick story. You guys epitomize the word sacrifice. Quick story, in 2011, it was about my third year as a farm director, and came home from the complex one day, and I told my wife, Allie, I said, you know, I'm starting to get that itch to go back on the field. And right away, she jumped, being so supportive, she jumped right back and said, well, go ahead and do it. And I said, well, you know, let me sit down and talk to the girls about it. So we had dinner that night. And the girls, they were younger, obviously 10, 11 years younger. And I told them, I said, you know, I've been in the office for 3 years. I don't think I like it that much. My passion's on the field. I'm getting an itch to go back on the field. Right away, they jumped and said, just go ahead and do it. And I said, not so fast. There's a couple of things we got to talk about. The first thing is finances. Obviously, a farm director makes a hell of a lot more money than a minor league manager. This house we're living in, we're probably going to have to downsize from this house and go into a condo close to the school in Phoenix. And then the last thing, and most importantly, is I'm going to have to go to winter ball, continue to go to winter ball, and make ends meet. And that'll take me another 3.5 months away from the house. And they snapped right back at me and said, how in the world can you tell us to chase our dreams if you're not chasing yours? I can't thank you enough for that. I can't thank you for the sacrifices that you guys have made for this day right here. You guys are my rock. You've supported me throughout. I wouldn't be sitting up here without you. Thank you. At home watching and always in my heart, my dad, Pedro Grifol Sr., my mom, Gloria Campos, my grandmother, Gori Vasquez, one of the strongest women I know, my sisters, Monica and Nicole, my brother, Andrew, and the rest of my family, friends, and agent. I've taken the road less traveled to this position. And when you do that, you definitely don't sit up here alone. So please bear with me as I mention a few of these people who have invested so much in me. Mike Martin Sr., John McMichin, who hired me as a scout in 2000 in South Florida, the late Roger Youngward, Dayton Moore, thank you for your leadership, George Brett, Ted Simmons, John Bowles, and Dave Wallace, thank you for sharing your knowledge when you didn't have to. Ned Joes, Mike Matheny, Eduardo Perez, Raul Ibanez, Steve Phillips, Rafael Colon, Gene Watson, and so many more. I can't thank you enough for your tough love and friendship throughout the years. Lastly, I want to thank the staff and players in Kansas City the last 10 seasons, especially Salvador Perez. Te quiero, caballo. I know you're watching. I've been in this division the last 10 years, and I know this club well. It's an extremely talented club on both sides of the field, both sides of the ball. Without getting too deep into here are some of the things that you can expect from the 2023 White Sox. We will communicate. Aquí falta de comunicación no va a haber. We will be fundamentally sound. We will play with passion, pride for this uniform. This means something. We will respect the game, our fans, and earn their trust. We will be prepared to control the strike zone on both sides of the ball. We will work hard and play winning baseball every night. And we will definitely hold each other accountable. I truly see great things happening here, and I'm really excited to be a part of it. Thank you.
We will open up for questions now. Bruce?
First of all, Pedro, welcome to Chicago. Congratulations.
Thank you.
One of the major disconnects it appeared in the last year for the White Sox was dealing with injury and how to
go out there and try to perform injured, and it's still point being able to give 100%. How would you deal with that situation, which appeared to be a big problem for the White Sox players understanding that message?
Well, I think it starts in spring training with an individual plan, right? And just making sure that these guys are getting some time off. You know, as we raise the bar in the intensity of the practices, you also got to give them a little bit of rest and recovery. So when the season starts, we're going to communicate extremely well with the guys. They're going to know exactly when they're going to have days off, so that they can give us the very best, knowing that they might have a Sunday off with a Monday scheduled off day. So I think communication is a big part of this thing. And I also know that we have to collaborate. We have to have a collaborated effort when it comes to guys' bodies and how they go about it. You know. So, and I think when I talk about the sports,
Still working.
Okay. Basically, communication, talking to the trainers, strength and conditioning, instead of a plan for each and every player.
Just as a follow-up. The message last year was, we want you to play hurt, but we want you not to go 100%. How would you handle that situation as you being the manager?
You know, that's a good question. I mean, guys play hurt and through pain all the time. Sometimes you got to back off a little bit to keep these guys on the field. So it's going to be communication on my part with the player to see how much he can really give us that night. And if we feel that he's going to help us win that night, then he'll play. If not, we'll give him the day off and wait till the next day.
Mark.
Pedro, congratulations. You were with the Royals, so you got a good look at this White Sox team. You see the abundance of talent. I guess on the flip side, what did you see from across the field that you thought might have been maybe missing a little bit for, you know, a team that underachieved last year?
Well, like I said before, this is an extremely talented ball club. And it was a really difficult club to prepare for, because if the energy was high, they can beat anybody in the game. And if the energy wasn't, you know, we were able to, you know, to have some success against them. So my job's going to be, and our staff's job's going to be, to make sure that energy is high every night and we're prepared to win the ball game.
Go ahead, Benny.
Rick, you mentioned a lot of things about outside the organization. Pedro is obviously from outside the organization. As you guys embarked on this process and found your next manager, what are the things that Pedro brings from outside the organization that you guys needed in here?
I think all organizations run the risk of becoming a little insular, and you know, I think all 30 of us are guilty of falling in love with our own guys that you draft and develop and have, whether you've traded for or signed as free agents, with expectations. And sometimes it's good to get a little bit of a reality check from outside and a more objective point of view, let's say. And I will say, I think it was important given, you know, some of the processes over the last few turnovers that we've had, to make clear that we were open-minded to different points of view and that we were interested in what others had to say about us and how we were perceived and how we could get better. We obviously have had a fair amount of success, but not enough. And when you get to that point of frustration that we all felt last year and knowing that you needed to change perhaps the way we went about some things, I think it was essential for us to hear from as many different voices as we could about how to get this thing better and how to get it on track. Doesn't mean that we don't have some very high caliber coaches and scouts as part of this organization. It's a matter of complementing those points of view from time to time and getting a little bit of a reality check, perhaps.
And to follow up, Pedro, what are some of the new ideas or fresh perspectives that you can bring to this organization?
Well, communication is one of the biggest parts of my leadership, right? And I think it's really important that you empower players, you empower coaches, you collaborate. Everybody's a big part of this. I think our successes are tied together. And raising the energy level every single day is extremely important. As far as, you know, new ideas and analytics and all this stuff, you know, I'm well versed in this stuff. Ideas are stuff that come up daily, especially when you have a very creative staff. But we're just going to be prepared to play. We're going to work hard, and we're going to be prepared to play.
One thing I want to amplify from that, and not to get too deep into the weeds, but we spent a lot of time with Pedro talking through improvements to our pregame planning, something that he was heavily involved in the past, as well as our how we prepare from an offensive standpoint to get the most out of the traits of the players on the roster. How we go about our business in that area in particular, I think you're going to see a lot different from what we had in the past.
Andrew,
I know. Here we go.
Hi, Andy Seligman, AP. This is for both of you. 2-3 years ago, this was a young, vibrant, fun-loving team. How important is it to get that energy back, and how do you go about restoring that?
I'll start with saying it's essential. I mean, look, we felt extremely proud of what we were able to accomplish in the early parts of this rebuild and the position that we were in a few years back. Even though we decided that we had to make a change after 2020, I think it was pretty clear that the arrow was pointing up for us. And thus far, what we've been able to show for that is one division title and a first-round exit. And that's not who we envisioned ourselves being. And part of that sort of disappointment, I think, permeated the way the clubhouse was viewed or viewed itself. Recapturing that energy, that excitement, keeping the language clean, but some of the things that we talked about in terms of our attitude and approach of how we're going to go about a game, that we're going to be, again, keeping it clean, we're there to beat you, and to exploit every edge that that presents itself to us along the way.
I just think it starts in spring training. I think when we hit the field in spring training, the level of intensity to our practices, the level of intensity to our cage work, the details, attacking margins are going to be extremely critical in developing the culture and the chemistry of this club. And I think I think these players are hungry for it. I think they want it. And once we get started, they're going to see how prepared they're going to be to, again, keeping it clean, kick somebody's butt.
Let's go over here, Jeff. Sorry. Coach?
Hey, Joe. First of all, welcome to Chicago. I'm sure that you've looked this roster up and down, and of course, being in the same division with this team. What would you think, from your perspective, would be the most pressing needs that you would like to see filled on this team?
Well, we got to improve defensively, obviously. And I feel that fundamentally, we got to improve. And again, I go back to the intensity level and the energy that we got to bring to our preparation. This is a very good club. It's a club that's prepared to win, to do great things. And I personally just I'm gonna be a stickler to the preparation, the energy is gonna get us where we want to go. These guys are gonna come to play every single night. You know, as far as adding and subtracting from our roster, we haven't really gotten there yet. I think we will at some point here in the next couple weeks. But I just think this club is prepared to do great things. And I think with a few adjustments on just the mental side of it and the approach to our practices and our preparation, it's going to be sufficient.
Would you like to see a Jose Abreu in your future?
I think all 30 managers want to see a Jose Abreu in their in their lineup. I mean, he's obviously a guy from the other side that when you see him play, he comes to play every day. He works hard. He plays hurt. He performs. He's performed for a long time. But again, we have to sit down and see how this roster shakes out in the next couple of weeks and beyond and see where we go from there.
Pedro, as far as Montoya goes, I'm curious if you had a past relationship with him, and in any case, what stood out to you as a fit as the bench coach?
We've spoken a few times, but I just have so much respect for him and what he's done in the game. Here's a guy that was in the minor leagues for a long time as a minor league manager, got an opportunity to get to the big leagues. He was a bench coach for Tampa. He's extremely smart, bilingual, got a chance to manage in the American League East. I'm really excited to bring him on board. I think he's going to help us. He's going to help me tremendously.
But how important do you think it is to have someone who's done the managerial, been in that seat before for your first go around in the big leagues in this position?
You'll hear me say this 1,000 times. If I'm the smartest guy in the room, we got a problem. You know, so I think it's extremely important. This guy's done it, right? He's done it the last 3 years. He's had success, and I'm really happy to have him on board.
Go with Cheryl. We're here, Jeff. Sorry. Thanks.
Hi, Pedro. Cheryl Ray Stout with WBEZ Radio. As far as your staff, your coaching staff, what attributes are you looking for in some of the coaches you want to hire?
Communication skills is the most important thing for me. And a lot of these guys that we're discussing are bilingual. Relational skills is extremely important. They got to be detailed. Their work ethic's got to be off the charts. Creativity is important. You can't stay the same. You got to keep moving forward and attacking margins. So there are some attributes we're looking at. But to start communication skills are the top of the list.
How do you like to work with your staff? Do you like them to have autonomy, or do you like them to be part of it all the time?
We're all in this thing together. I anticipate everybody feeling comfortable going out of their lane with respect. I anticipate that. I want that. I want people telling me, I want our staff telling me what they feel we need to do on a daily basis that's going to improve us and prepare us to play. I think it's going to be an enjoyable environment where they're going to be free and comfortable to go out and teach and do what they do best.
Hey, Lamond.
Hey, Pedro, you mentioned the journey that you took to get here. Just what was that moment like when you got the call that you're going to be the next Sox manager?
It was extremely emotional. I've been in this game a long time, and all I've ever wanted to do was manage a baseball team. Right? And it didn't matter if it was the minor leagues or the big leagues I wanted to manage. This game has a tendency to kind of grab you and take you other places. And if you don't check yourself, you're going to end up somewhere where your passion doesn't sit, right? And that's where I was. You know, this game took me into a scouting world. Then it brought me back to managing, took me to a field coordinator, and then it grabbed me and took me into the front office. And I was excited for a little bit, but after a couple, 2-3 years, you know, that's not where my passion was. It's here on the field. It's wearing this uniform. And thank God I have them right there that they just made all the sacrifices in the world for me to be able to, you know, continue to do this. And here we are.
John.
Hey guys, you talked about that first meeting, and you know, Rick, I'm curious what he said or what he kind of gave off that made you so convinced he might be the guy. And Pedro, I was kind of curious your approach to going into that meeting. You've wanted to be a manager for a long time. What was your approach, and what did you kind of want to? How do you want to market yourself, I guess, to this?
You know, I think in that first meeting, where he essentially knocked our socks off. We obviously had done a fair amount of due diligence beforehand on all these guys. It's part of the reason he was part of the eight that we decided to sit down with. And I'd heard a great deal from people who had worked with him before, former players who had been with him, about his sort of special level of communication, his level of empathy for players, his ability to not sort of have broad proclamations and this is who we are, but understanding each individual and what they need in order to achieve. I also understood that he was heavily involved in some pregame preparation and in terms of crafting sort of an offensive attitude for the team. And those were sort of points that I wanted to follow up and find out if they were real or not. Obviously, you're not hiring someone's reputation or who they worked for or their credentials. You're hiring the man in this instance. And coming out of that meeting, he came across as the real deal when it comes to connecting with people, motivating them, crafting a detailed, oriented plan for winning a ball game. And it really just clicked. I think that first meeting was, at least internally, you probably didn't know this, was supposed to be about 90 minutes. And I think we met for about almost 3.5 hours that day. Because it was just a hell of a conversation. As I said, as we walked out of there, you know, the bar was set extremely high for everyone else. And frankly, I had to check myself a couple of times to make sure I was going into subsequent interviews, you know, with a fully open mind. And Jeremy and Getze and Daniel did a good job of sort of keeping me on track with that, because, you know, thoughts kept drifting back to Pedro.
You know, for me, this is, I think, my fifth or sixth interview with different clubs. So what I do, what I got to do is just grab all my experiences and put them together. You know, I talk about all the things that I've done. I wouldn't change a thing. I know it's taken a long time for me to get to this seat, but I wouldn't change a thing, because every job I've done in this game have given me the resources to be able to troubleshoot anything that may come my way. I might not have the answer, but at some point, somewhere in a job that I had before, I'll find a way to troubleshoot whatever comes my way. So having interviews with different clubs, my approach remained the same. I just go in there and be who I am, what I really believe. Empathy is a big part of this thing. Communication is a big part of it. And basically my message is, you're seeing the guy today who you're going to see February 1st, the first day of spring training. I'm not going to sell you something that might sound good today, and then all of a sudden I'm somebody else when the time comes. That's not who I am. Who you see here sitting today is who you're going to see on February 1st, who you're going to see in June, July. And sometimes teams like that, sometimes they don't, you know, but I can't change. I can't change that. And all I can do is just go in there and you know, talk about what I'm going to do and who I am.
James.
Rick, could you kind of talk more about the process? I think you guys were the last team to fill your vacancy. You obviously took your time and was extensive. Is this the most extensive process you've been part of? And you talked about also learning about your organization through it. So in broad strokes, I imagine, what did you kind of learn about your organization through this process? And I think a lot of people latched on to you talking about looking at recent winning organizations. So how did you kind of discern the qualities that Pedro brought from, you know, the Royals' recent struggles and whether or not anything was connected?
Don't tell people in this town that 2015, 2016 was a long time ago. Half the town will be pretty upset with you. A few things there. First, you asked about the process. Again, it was very extensive. It was, at one point, actually, I think about two-thirds of the way through it, I was on the phone with Jerry, and as we were talking through the candidates and where things sat and what was coming next, he said, you know what this process reminds me of? And frankly, I could have gone either way. Didn't quite know what the chairman, where he was going at that point. But he said, this reminds me of the process the Bulls used when we hired our tourists. And that made me proud that, you know, because although we did not necessarily coordinate with them or get any sort of blueprint from them, I know that they went about it in a way where they were open-minded, looked outside the organization, got recommendations from a numerous or diverse group of individuals from around the game, and wound up making a, what at least in my opinion is a sensational hire over there. So that that was good feedback, you know, midway through this process. We learned that a lot of our, that again, talking to people who had prepared to play us in recent years, you heard sort of that dichotomy between who we were in 20, even 19, 20, and part of 21, to what we became in the latter half of 21 and 22. A lot of that was sort of confirmation for what we thought we were seeing, but in sort of hearing what you were able to observe from the other dugout or what you were doing to prepare for us off of video and advancing, it became evident that there was a number of things in terms of our internal pregame processes and how we go about our business that needed to be tightened up. It's one thing to say, you know, we're not fundamentally strong and or defensively strong, or we need to run the bases better. It's good to hear a fresh perspective on how we're going to go about improving those. Again, you know, those shortcomings weren't for the lack of talent or lack of dedication from those coaches that may no longer be part of the staff. Hitting coach in particular, you know, we had a great deal of success back in 20 with multiple silver sluggers. You heard me talk about our offensive prowess in 21. Hitting coach is just a difficult job, has the shortest shelf life in the game of all the positions. And there does come a point where you need to make a change in that regard, despite the past success and talents of the individual, just because the message isn't getting through anymore. Coming up with different ways to address that and to deliver a solid message, whether it's tweaking the message or tweaking the drills and the prep work and how we go about preparing for an opponent, it was good to get some fresh perspectives on that as well.
David?
Pedro, you talk a lot about energy and intensity, a lot of old school principles you're going to bring here as the manager. How do you feel about the new modern baseball, integrating analytics and using those with the kind of the approach that you just described?
Analytics is a big part of the game. I mean, I'm well-versed in analytics. That's going to set the foundation for a baseball game, how to navigate a baseball game, there's no doubt. The team that we'll bring in for the hitting, they're going to be well-versed in analytics too. And their program's going to be geared for, you know, pitchers with vert and horizontal movement and, you know, so on and so forth. So analytics is a big part of this thing, and it's gonna lay the foundation on how we approach a given pitcher or a given team that particular night. However, these are humans, they're not robots, and you know, things change, and we got to be able to make adjustments. And, you know, given my experience of managing in winter ball and dealing with analytics, I feel like we'll have a good base on what we need to do in any given situation in a ball game, whether it's analytically or dealing with the human element.
Mark.
Oops, sorry. What's up?
Hey, Rick, while you were going through the managerial hire process, you had a month to digest what happened, you know, this past season. Maybe you digested it longer than the month. But when you look at the roster moving forward, do you have, in broad strokes, an idea whether you need to make, you know, I think people are trying to guess if you make, you know, wholesale, but significant changes or kind of supplement and add on to what you have in place right now?
I think we view this as still a championship caliber core. Obviously, we had significant regression across the board in several key players. I think job one is figuring out which of those are correctable and how are we going to get them back on track and performing at the levels that we previously saw and that I think was reasonable to project them for last season before they fell off. If we're able to accomplish that with numerous players, wholesale changes or a radical shift in direction is by no means necessary. Are there areas where we need to improve? Absolutely. We've hit on that already today, you know, whether it's from regaining our offensive approach, staying healthier. Those are two keys to our success going right forward. But improving ourselves defensively, how we run the bases, a little better lineup balance and approach to each at bat is called for as well. Whether that comes from internal improvement or external additions, ultimately we're hoping that's a combination of both, but we don't view this as, you know, drastic wholesale changes on the horizon. We need to get these guys back to the level they're capable of playing at.
When you're talking about the regression in certain players and you say you have to figure that out, I mean, it's got to be figured out kind of quickly, right? I mean, how do you put a finger on it, and what if it is fixable?
I'm sorry, what's the question?
I said, you know, you have to decide quickly on if you can fix the regression. So how do you figure out whether it is or isn't fixed?
I mean, there's certainly a analytical element to that in terms of looking at the underlying performance and what's replicable, repeatable going forward, or what's, you know, a cause of concern. There's the health element. We have to understand exactly, you know, what guys are potentially dealing with going forward and how we can project their health and availability going forward. But then there's also, look, the roster, we had a few guys playing out of position last year, just out of the way the roster fit together, and then driven even more significantly due to the injuries. We want to avoid that going forward. We want to get forward to the point where we have guys playing in a role they're more suited for. And if that means we got to make some alterations to the roster from the outside, that's what we'll have to, the route we'll have to go.
You're good, Vinny?
Yeah.
Okay. David, last one.
Rick, Pedro said he had talked to Charlie Montoyo a few times in the past. Was adding him as the bench coach based on his experience your idea or his idea, or how did that come about?
It was a collaborative effort. It was something we talked about, I think, in our second meeting. It didn't come up during the first. It came up during the second. Look, Charlie's got a sterling reputation in this game and is viewed as one of the finer bench coaches of the last decade plus or so. Obviously, the world knew he was available. It tends to be a little bit of an insular community, so we knew that there was competition. There were multiple other teams pursuing Charlie. So midway through the interview process, we started talking about potential fits, and we certainly weren't looking to arrange any sort of marriage where the manager wasn't fully on board. Turns out that Pedro, I don't know if he raised it first or I raised it first during the second conversation, but it was going to be part of it, and certainly his enthusiasm from the jump was clear.
Pedro, Rick, thank you. Pedro, congratulations. I believe we're going to head out to the field to take some photos, so I think that's the next stop. And then people who are doing one-on-ones will get set up. But check in with the media relations staff. That's not my bailiwick. Thanks for coming, everybody.
Okay, this is Larry Hawley, WGN News Now. We have just completed the Pedro Grifol news conference where he's been introduced as the Chicago White Sox manager. We're going to have a few recaps coming up here, just a little bit on what's been going on and what he had to say. But we first of all wanted to reach out to you here on Facebook who are watching this news conference. We wanted to let you know that if you would like to, we are taking your comments about the White Sox manager. We're going to go ahead and take some of those here as we go along. So if you're still watching this stream on Facebook, or if you're watching on the website, if you want to come on over to Facebook, even if you're watching on YouTube, and have some comments here about the White Sox new manager, Pedro Grifol, we're happy to share them. I'll share in a few in a couple of minutes. But wanted to go ahead and talk a little bit about today. We're going to go ahead and switch that up. Actually, have a little bit of a thing here. We're going to having some trouble. We were going to try to get it here. There's the video. I knew we had it. The White Sox introduction of Pedro Grifol. You can see him walking into Guaranteed Rate Field this morning, probably about an hour before the news conference got underway. Walked in just around 11 a.m. The traditional introductions you'll see coming up here. They had the traditional jersey ceremony where Rick Hahn posed with Grifol, who will wear number 5, although no guarantees either way that Josh Harrison, who currently wears that for the White Sox, will not be back next year, but Grifol gets number 5 at the moment. Now, to talk a little bit about what Grifol had to say, one thing that he did mention a lot was communication. He said communication will be an important part of his club moving forward. There was also discussion from both Grifol and from Hahn. One thing that was really big for them was talking about the preparation before the game for the White Sox. The team obviously going outside the organization, looking for some different perspectives on how to get ready after going 81-81 last season and having a very disappointing campaign, one which many thought they would win the AL Central, and that didn't end up happening. So communication, a big part of what they said, along with changes in pregame preparation. Another thing that I wanted to point out here is that Grifol believes the White Sox can do great things, and he said he will be, quote, a stickler when it comes to preparation. He said the energy is going to get them where they want to go. Rick Hahn also talked about how important it is to bring the energy back into the clubhouse in 2023 so the White Sox can get back on track to where they were just a few years ago. Now, taking a look at a couple other things that were said today, Rick Hahn confirming that Charlie Montoyo, the former Blue Jays manager, will be the team's new bench coach. Ethan Katz, the pitching coach, and the assistant pitching coach, Kurt Hassler, will also return to the staff as well. So there's going to be a little bit of a transition that there's going to be able to help there. Some of the White Sox coaches from last year, but a lot of them are going to be gone. Frank Menachino, the hitting coach, is also out for the White Sox. So changes certainly ahead for the club as Pedro Grifol now takes over as the manager. Now, a lot of people are wondering who Pedro Grifol is because a lot of people did not hear about him until he was hired as the manager either today or obviously some of the reports came out about 48 hours earlier. So right now we're going to take some time here to talk a little bit about who Pedro Grifol is. And he was obviously a manager of the Kansas City Royals. He was the coach for the Kansas City Royals since 2013. He served in a number of different roles, and that's kind of been one of the themes that he's had here when he's been in baseball. With Kansas City, he was the bench coach the last 3 years. Also the hitting, catching, and quality control coach during his time at the major league level with that club. Now, that was preceded by his time with the Seattle Mariners from 2000 through 2012. He had a number of scouting roles. He was first an area scout for about 5 years, then became the coordinator of instruction, and then the director of operations from 2008 through 2011. Now, he also, during the 2010 season, served as a coach on the major league level for the Mariners. Some of you might be asking, you know, what was his experience when it came to being a manager? Well, we have that for you right here. This is what Grifol has done as a manager. When he was with the Mariners, he was the manager of the Class A Everett team from 2003 to 2005. And then he was the Class A High Desert manager in 2012. Now, as a member of the Mariners and as a member of the Royals, he also had experience when it came to managing in the winter leagues, doing so in Venezuela in 2010 through 2013, and then in the Dominican Winter League. That was during the 2018-2019 season. So it's not the first time that Grifol has been a manager. So it's certainly something that will be new to him. But he spoke all the time during his news conference today about how much he always wanted to be a manager. He even praised his family for the sacrifices that they made so that he could get out of scouting and go back into the dugout and pursue this dream. As you saw, his first managerial job was in Everett in 2003. So this has been a long journey for Grifol to try to get back here and try to become the leader of a major league ball club. It happens here with the White Sox on November 3rd of 2022. Now we're going to go ahead and go to the Facebook. If you have some comments about the White Sox new manager, please go ahead and let us know. I'm going to look through some of them here, kind of going through a few, just working our way through. If we can, Ramiro joining in here on the live stream. Hope he can turn the team into a winning team. Wanted to mention one thing that was talked about a few times by Grifol is the fact that he believes the White Sox are not very far away from reaching the goal that many people thought that they would back in 2021 or 2022. He believes the talent is here and that with a few adjustments, the White Sox will be able to find a way to work themselves back into their championship window, which in many ways they still are. But Rick Hahn really talked about the fact that he believes that this group does not need wholesale changes, that at the end of the day, they just need some improvement from players, improvement in the pregame energy in the clubhouse, and he believes that will be the key for the White Sox to doing what they can do. Andy has kind of the opinion of a lot of people that I've seen here. Let's see what happens. I think there's a lot of people who don't know a lot about Grifol, and they're kind of eager to see what he might be able to bring here. Not willing to rule him out. They're not exactly super excited, but a number of White Sox people are kind of just, you know, fans, or either those, or just kind of waiting to see what might become of him as things go along. Quincy weighing in here with a big theme, at least the last part of it, new manager, new beginning, and a fresh start. Again, one thing that Rick Hahn really wanted to have in this managerial hire, he mentioned it at the news conference where Tony La Russa resigned due to health issues, that the club was really looking for some fresh perspective from the outside. They hadn't had it. As you might have read on WGNTV.com, Grifol is the first White Sox manager not to have worked for the club or played for the club since Gene Lamont back in 1992. That's the last hire. when looking at it before, Terry Bevington, who took over for Lamont in 1995 when he was fired, he was the third base coach. Jerry Manuel worked briefly for the White Sox as a scout. After that, of course, Ozzie Guillen, a three-time All-Star for the White Sox, a Gold Glove winner, the American League Rookie of the Year in 1985. Lots of history with the club. Robin Ventura, another All-Star, another Gold Glove winner. He took over for Ozzie. And then there's Rick Renteria. Now, again, kind of like Jerry Manuel, not a ton of time. Rick was there for the 2016 season as the bench coach for Robin Ventura. He then took over after that. And then, of course, Tony La Russa, a very long history with the White Sox. His whole managerial career began with the club in 1978 as he first was a manager in Knoxville in the minor leagues. 1979, La Russa became the White Sox manager halfway through the season for Don Kessinger. And then, of course, he managed through the 1986 season before he was fired. But in that process, La Russa had four winning seasons for the White Sox in the 1980s. That included the 1983 Western Division Championship, the first White Sox playoff appearance in 24 years, and the first appearance for any Chicago baseball team in the postseason in 24 years. Going to keep looking here through the comments. Look, let's go with Dennis. Dennis commenting on this. Maybe speaking of the future looks brighter from where I'm sitting. I expect some players will be moving on before spring. That's baseball. As soon as the World Series ends, good time to start keeping up with the transactions. Very interesting you mentioned, was first of all, about the World Series. A lot of times when it comes to managerial announcements, it's usually done on the day off of the World Series. Now, today, there's obviously Game 5. Why the White Sox were able to keep doing that is because Game 3 was originally rained out in Philadelphia, so the schedule shifted. So the White Sox expected to have this news conference on Thursday, which was supposed to be the day off between Game 5 and Game 6. But as Rick Hahn mentioned at the beginning of his news conference, that they were able to have this go on with Major League Baseball's blessing. So that's there. Some players will be moving on. We've already reportedly heard that the Sox are looking to move on from Jose Abreu. Perhaps Andrew Vaughn now takes his natural position at first base. But as you heard, Pedro, a big fan of Jose. So never say never when it comes to what he might be able to do if indeed Jose can come back. Don chiming in. Another positive support. Welcome to the White Sox, regardless of the players and coaching staff. Still supports the team 100%. A lot of fans, obviously, doing what they can do to keep up the good vibes. It was a very disappointing 2022 season as the club went 81-81. Difficult times for the Sox, but again, you know, a new, fresh voice, someone who's new, someone who's not worked for the organization, now gets his opportunity to go ahead and see what he can do for the White Sox. Let's go ahead and recap the day. Pedro Grifol named the White Sox new manager. He is the 42nd man to hold that role in the history of the franchise. He comes to the White Sox after spending the last 10 seasons as a member of the Kansas City Royals organization, the last three as their bench coach. He was with the Seattle Mariners organization from 2010 through 2012, serving in a variety of scouting roles, and of course, he was also a manager in their system as well. We'll get to that in just a little bit. Grifol taking over for Tony La Russa, who resigned due to health issues at the end of the 2022 season. His run was 2 years. And as we mentioned before, Grifol has not been a manager at the major league level, but he has been a manager before. Class A Everett with the Mariners 2003 to 2005. Class A High Desert with Seattle in 2012. And of course, his two stints in the Winter League in Venezuela from 2010 through 2013. And then the Dominican Winter League in 2018 and 2019, doing so while a member of the Kansas City Royals organization. We thank you so much for tuning in to this live edition here of WGN News Now as we had the Pedro Grifol introductory news conference here online. Want to remind you that this news conference will be online in a couple of minutes for you to view if you want to check out any of the comments that he talked about, hear Rick Hahn talk glowingly about the new manager, and also hear Grifol talk very positively about this current White Sox group, which he believes can be very special and fulfill all those goals they had when the White Sox began their rebuild in the late winter of 2016. But for right now, I'm Larry Hawley. Thank you so much for joining me for this live edition of WGN News Now, and have a wonderful day.